I would like. You've heard it before, but I think it's going to be a little different tonight. All right, this is page 12. All right, and if you need a book, borrow one. If you don't have it, I'll loan you one. Need one? Okay. Okay, now the scripture text tonight, and I could just deal with the questions, but we'll see how we come out. The questions are at the end of the chapter, but we just wanted to start with the scriptures. Colossians 3, 1, 2. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections, rather, on things above, not on things on the earth. Okay, check that out. Okay, so does that sound like a scripture that would be referring to having God's interest at heart? Does that seem like, okay, okay. Why, Sister Irene, why does that seem like it might be out of scope with scripture?
Because when it refers to things that above, it's talking about the things of God.
Okay.
Not worldly things or natural things. Mm-hmm.
All right, so it speaks about seeking those things above and setting your affection on things above, not on things of the earth. Amen. So it seems like this has to be something that just won't happen by itself. It has to be a conscious decision, a choice. There's something, you have to make the decision that you want to what? Have God's interest in heart. Is that right? Right, so there's a choice you have to make, and strangely enough, there's a lot of people, I mean, ministers, you know, everywhere you go, you find people that's interested in showboating. They're interested in a whole lot of things other than setting their affections above. Amen. This is the thing that I feel that will mean more to people today than any other thing. Amen. Seeking those things above and setting your affections on things above, not on things of the earth. Why is it not wise to set your affection on things on the earth? Why do you think that that's not, you know, there are many scriptures that says seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Don't seek things. Things will seek you if you seek God first. So why is it unwise to set your affections on things on the earth? All right, they're going to what? Pass away. Okay, what's going to happen to temple things when Jesus comes? Oh, well, I hate to see all of my hardware, all of my savings and investments or whatever. Maybe we better try to get rid of some of them right now. Amen. Someone said only what you do for Christ will what?
Yes.
Only what you do for Christ will be counted in the end. Amen. So that's the admonition from Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2. Okay, Philippians 2, 19 through 21. I like this. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. Okay, so we can see from that scripture, you know, I guess the little commentary on that is on page 16, a little commentary on Philippians 2, 19 through 21. verse 19, you know, just got through reading that, but I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state, who will be genuinely interested in your welfare and devoted to your interests. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ's. For the others all seek to advance their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. Okay, these were speaking about Paul, you know, those are servants and those that are followers of Paul, I guess his entourage and so forth. But note one says, Paul had many fellow laborers in the gospel, but Timothy was the only one that seemed to have had a genuine interest in the welfare of the saints. He was completely devoted to their care and their spiritual progress. And that's good. That's nice. Nice statement. All right, note two, what an indictment against God's representatives and ambassadors whose role is to speak on the Lord's behalf and to represent the Lord's interest. So we as believers, you know, we are to be what? God's ambassadors and God's what? Representatives. And what an indictment, but that's the way it goes many times. Okay, over on page 13, on page 13 it says in 1 Corinthians 3, now we are laborers together with God, we are ambassadors for Christ. And it says an ambassador, this is down C, under C, an ambassador does two things, speak on behalf of the one he represents and promotes the interests of the one he represents. Okay, so that's a little commentary. The call and commission have been clearly stated. We are laborers with him. We are to continue all that Jesus began to do and teach. We are his only representatives or ambassadors upon the earth. We are to speak on his behalf, promote his interests, and do what Jesus would do if he was here on the earth personally. So I want to go back to that scripture. Why is it y'all feel that it is so difficult for God's people to understand, you know, all of us witness, you know, there are times that we might be a little bit more committed and interested in the things of God. And then there are sometimes it seems like the cares of life, whatever, what has happened sometimes? The deceitfulness of riches and circumstance and just routines. I mean, sometimes it just drains a whole lot out of you when you have to go through the things that we have to go through. Everybody agree? It's kind of hard to be totally committed to carrying out the will of God many times when you have so many distractions in your life and when so many things are pulling after you. And it's not easy, is that right? It's not easy. Okay, so many times, you know, we just get distracted and we get away from doing the things that God really wants us to place primary, you know, focus on. And this is what we are trying to do. I'm trying to be a good pastor because I want everybody to have some stars in the crown. I want all of these blessings, you know, not only crowns, but there will be positions of authority. We're going to reign with Christ. We're going to be given a whole lot of accolades, you know, in the kingdom of God. But it's all going to be contingent upon our service down here on earth. God is going to base whatever we're going to be rewarded. Amen. We're going to get rewards. Amen. If we work for the Lord, and if we do it in the power of the Holy Spirit, and amen, if we do what the Lord says do, we will be rewarded. And there will be all different kinds of rewards administered at the judgment seat of Christ for faithfulness, for name some of them. We're going to be rewarded for faithfulness. Be faithful unto what? Death. And I'll give you a what?
Crown.
Okay, there's going to be a crown of what? Life. There's going to be a soul winner's crown. Is that right? There's going to be a crown. Blessed are they that endure temptation. For when they are tried, they shall receive what? Amen. A crown of life. Amen. So suffering will be a crown of life. There's going to be about five different crowns that will be a soul winner's crown, a crown of rejoicing. This will be the soul winner's crown, shepherd's crown, and crown for faithfulness, crown for suffering, going through hardships. You know, sometimes we have to persevere. We have to push ourselves. We have to suffer hardness as a what? Good soldier. But it's going to all be what? Rewarded. Amen. So don't be, Scripture says, don't be, by well-doing, don't be what? Weary by well-doing, because we're going to what?
Reap
if we what?
Thank God.
Amen. We faint not. So there are some good things awaiting us. And I just don't want any of us to be disappointed. Amen. So that's the reason why I'm calling people back to what? That sincere and pure devotion to Christ. Amen. So make sure that whatever we do, amen, it's going to be what? The best that we have to what? To present. Is that right? Y'all believe I'm on the right track? Amen. Praise God. I'm telling you, it just, you know, I wish y'all could take some trips and go around these places. And, you know, I'm telling you, churches. You can just see the superficiality. You can just see, you know, you never hear anything about, you know, sanctification, seeking God, and holiness, and being sincere, and you know, enduring hardness, things like that. We just are not hearing a whole lot about today. But we do know the Word of God has not what? Changed. Mm-hmm. God is, the Scripture says, Jesus Christ is the same what? Yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. So, we read the Scripture about Timothy was the only person that Paul could find that really had the people at heart. Really, really was concerned with the people. So that is the attitude that we want to develop here at this church. We want everybody really begin to develop an interest in the spiritual welfare, whatever physical welfare, the emotional welfare of the people here, and not just the people here, but people, you know, he wants us to be concerned about what all men, those that we are coming in contact with. Amen. So this is the reason why we need to pray for the saints. How many believe that we need prayer?
Amen.
Amen. I've been really challenged lately. I'm going to give you a little tip. I've been given a challenge to how to pray most effectively for the saints. Because the saints really need it, right? Some saints are just holding on by what? Skin of the teeth. Amen. God is able to keep us from falling, but there's something that what? We got to do. Okay, now I want you to just write these scriptures down and how to pray for the saints. The best way to pray for the saints would be, see, Paul's prayer was that, that in Ephesians, one, he prayed that the eyes of our understanding might be enlightened. Because many times we can get dull of hearing, our perception and sensitivity to the Holy Spirit begins to be, get what? Really, really kind of off. So praying that the eyes of our understanding might be enlightened is a huge prayer. And the reason he prayed that in Ephesians is that so that he has the Father, so that we might know. There are several few things that he...
What scripture do you get this in Ephesians?
Ephesians 1. Ephesians 1. Okay, 16:16 says, I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayer. Okay, that's a good point too. Paul was consistently giving thanks to God for the saints. And I think that that's a good practice that all of us need to follow. Pray. Okay. Ephesians 1:16, okay, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him. See, if we had more wisdom and knowledge and a revelation of him, we could pretty well detect the things that we need to do. We would know where we are in the scheme of things that pertain to the end time, actually. We will be able to perceive a lot more. And when people are more perceptive and they are more sensitive to spiritual realities, then many times they will do a lot better. They will do a lot better. They will do things on their own, and nobody will have to what? Just tell them, amen, that we need to get back to, you know, reaching out to people and leading people to Christ and getting concerned about their souls. Okay, let me go further. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. All right, so what God has done for you and what God has placed in you, the inheritance, the riches of his grace, this is something definitely we need to really understand. What the investment that God has placed in us, Christ in us, the hope of glory. The potential and all of the rights and privileges that we have been given, all of those spiritual capabilities. If we only knew how rich we were, how anointed and all of the glorious attributes that Christ has placed in us. That, you know, that kind of stirs me to focus and try to build myself up also in the area of my rights and privileges in Christ, who I am in Christ. You know, that is probably the thing that comes natural after you focus on the Lord's compassion. You really want to know how this compassion, how this love, and all that Jesus is, you know, full of compassion, slow to anger, of great mercy, and all of the mercies that he makes available to us. This is the spirit that God wants us to absolutely be controlled and dominated by, the spirit of compassion. We have that same ability to work the works of Jesus. Scripture says the works that he did we can do also, because the works that he did weren't his. It was God doing those things, what? Through him. That's a lesson that we want to learn, is that how can we come to the point where we just cease from our strivings? Lord, I know I ain't about much, but you are about everything. Amen. If we can become nothing before God, if we could just come to the point where, Lord, whatever is done, teach me how to, whatever I do, I don't want to do any of it in the strength of my own ability. I just want to do it in the power of your might. You know, all of that is going to involve some disciplines, you know. Like Jesus had to what? He had to pray. And that was one reason why he spent more time in prayer than preaching and healing, because that was more important to him. Because he wouldn't know the Father's will, what direction. He wouldn't know the works that he was to do unless he got the mind of God in prayer. Amen. So we want to come to the point where we want God to be all and we nothing, and let God's power and the fullness of his ability really begin to flow through us. Amen. So this year, my intention is to really ask the Lord and let the Lord work and guide me and whatever discipline, whatever I need to do in order to position myself where God is all and James Hill is nothing. I believe God will be glorified. Amen. Amen. That's the reason why we need to pray, get out of ourselves when we pray. I'm going to agree with that.
Amen.
Lord, if I could get, like my brother Judah, I remember one Sunday, he got so happy. Man, I never seen him quake and shake and vibrate. And if we could get all these anointings aroused in this church here, well, we would have some revival. We would have some revival. But the question is, how do you get it? How do you get it released? It's not easy. Is that right? All right. Well, so see, he was here telling us that. Okay, well, I'm praying. Boy, I would be so happy. I probably, if I could get three people just to let go and let God.
What do you mean by that? We've heard that for ages. Let go and let God.
That means that completely surrender to God and let God work through him so everybody, well, people around us will be impacted. And that's what, you know, I'm kind of tired of being in church and going to churches, going to places, and everything, you know, nothing really meets the what? The core need in your spirit. Amen. But when we could just come to the point and just let God pray through it, let God have his way. Maybe you don't understand it. Let God have his way. the Bible says the humble shall hear thereof and they will be what?
It would be interesting. What does that mean to different people?
Oh, I'm scared to hear. I'm scared to ask.
You know, you've heard that for years, let go and let God. What does that mean to different people?
Okay, well, we will discuss that later. That is a very legitimate question.
And maybe, it is a legitimate question.
And maybe the women can break it down in a teaser.
No, we need to deal with it tonight.
I ain't finished reading this scripture here. The eyes of your understanding. You're trying to get me off my scripture. Okay, the riches of the glory of his inheritance. See, I'm speaking about the riches of what? The glory of his inheritance in the saints. Boy, there is a rich deposit in us. Boy, if we could just pick it out, if we could get it released, if we could just get this thing moving. Other night, I was really blessed. Monday night, I was blessed because Brother Travis was praying, and me and Brother Travis been talking. We've been said, Lord, we want you to do a new thing. And Brother Travis began that after about 15 or 20 minutes, you know what he did? I mean, he began to raise his voice really on high. And I said, man. And then Brother Wayne started praying, and Brother Wayne began to, man, he just poured out. I mean, he just got the mic and just poured out. Seemed like everything that they had was what? Poured out in that prayer. So I was telling Brother Travis, I said that if we start weeping and crying and breaking and letting the real us come out, the real spirit comes out, let God really what manifest himself and show himself strong, I believe somebody will be what impacted by that. I mean, this is the thing that really warms your heart and draws you in, encourage you, and it feeds the spirit. goes down to the core. When I left that prayer meeting, amen, I said, next time, Brother Travis, you know, maybe you can holler a little louder. Because usually when people will break, amen, people will break and they will what? Let God's way or whatever God wants to, however he wants to manifest, it comes out. And when that happens, many times the gifts will begin to work. The gifts of the Spirit. Okay. So the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. So we pray that the eyes of our understanding might be enlightened. So we will, you know, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe according to the working of his mighty power. So those are, that's one prayer. Another prayer that we can pray, Philippians 1:9. It's really a good prayer. Okay, Philippians 1:9. So I'm challenged to word my prayers in similar manner when I begin to pray for the saints, because I feel that there are specific things that we need to touch on when we begin to pray for the saints. Okay, for God is my record. This is Philippians 1:8. How greatly I long after you all in the bowels of Jesus Christ. And this I pray, that your love may abound, what? Yet more and more in what? Knowledge and in all judgment. That ye may approve things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ, unto the glory and praise of God. Now that covers a lot of territory, but all of that needs to be covered, and it would be beautiful if we would begin to focus on more of these things. If we want these things manifested, we will have to what? Pray them into our lives. We have to pray. Amen. Pray the word. Amen. So just look at the things that he mentioned there. And being filled with the fruits of righteousness. That means the fruits of righteousness is the things that we want to rekindle and revitalize. Filled with the fruit of... There's a lot of scriptures. A lot of them talk about being filled with the fruits of righteousness. The fruits of righteousness is basically reaching out, helping people, blessing them, ministering to them, and doing basically what Jesus would do if he were here on the earth. Those are the fruits of righteousness that God wants us. In fact, that's what we are called to do. Amen. What are we all about? We're his workmanship. Right? We just got through reading. We're his ambassadors. We are to what? Speak and act on his behalf. We are what? Co-laborers, workers together, what? With it. We are here, amen. We are here on this earth in Christ's stead. Are we doing a good job? Are we good representatives? Are we good ambassadors? Are we good laborers? Scale 1 to 10, where are we? Y'all think about it. Right, amen. Y'all think about that. Okay, but these are the prayers that you want to focus on. Now, I'm going to just point these out so that you can, at your leisure, Colossians 1:9. It's the same type prayer. See, many times we as believers, we are at a loss. Many times when we begin to pray for the saints, we don't know exactly what to do. Bless them, Lord. But I think that we could be a lot more specific and pray a lot more specifically for the needs of the saints, because all saints are going to have basically what? The same need. Okay, so I think it would be good to meditate these scriptures, and in your prayer time, amen, let's begin to what? Say these things to God for the saints. Amen. How many believe that prayer, the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous, avails much?
Amen.
Amen. See, Paul was saying that I have nobody like-minded. He said that I can't trust, you know, all of these preachers and workers. I can't find hardly anybody that's really genuinely interested in the people, that really have their interest, what, at heart. And so this is a way that we can really begin to what? Develop the interest that we should have for the saints. Amen. This is a must. Colossians 1, it says that, for this cause we also, since the day we heard of it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. So you see that praying for the eyes of our understanding and the eyes of the believers, the saints' eyes, that is a major thing. You think God is going to open the eyes of the understanding of the saints if nobody pray? Specifically for them, we got to pray. Amen. Am I making any sense?
Amen.
Okay. That we might walk worthy of the Lord. Pray that the saints may walk worthy. Lord, we pray that the saints of Northside Christian Center will walk worthy of the Lord. Unto all pleasing, being what? Fruitful in every what? And increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might, according to his glorious power. Now just write these down because I don't have time to read all, but there are many scriptures. Colossians 4:12, laboring fervently for you in prayers that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. Amen. If somebody laid hands on me, Sister Irene, and said, Pastor, Lord, I pray, Pastor, to stand perfect and complete in all of the will of God. Well, that would be a powerful prayer. I'll receive it. You can put your hands on me now. Look at that. Stand what? Perfect and complete in all the will of God. See, how will the saints ever come to perfection if we don't pray? If we don't pray that they come what? To perfection. And then we see people drifting, distracted, don't show up. Leave no aside, don't even talk to the pastor. All kind of stuff. All right, write it down. 1 Thessalonians 3:3. You just read Colossians 3, Colossians 4:12. 1 Thessalonians, I believe, 3. It was 3:13, I believe. Okay? 12:13. So tonight we're just focusing on positioning ourselves to really help the saints, you know, having God's interest at heart. So Paul was trying to find somebody that really had the heart of the people, amen, and the care of the people and the need of the people at heart, amen. Sometimes that's easy to do. I mean, you can get so distracted, get so involved, so busy, until, you know, man, you could care less about praying for the pastor, praying for the saints. You know, sometimes, you know, your mind don't even reflect on it because we got so many things that we have to take care of. All right, the Lord make you to increase in value and love one toward another, and toward all men, even as we toward you. The Lord make you to increase and abound in love one toward another. See, this is speaking about those fruits of righteousness. And there are many scriptures over and over and over and over and over and over said that we need to what? Abound more and more in what? In love. Abound more and more in love. That's the reason why I feel that it's going to be good for you, like on Sunday mornings, you know, try to connect with people. Just try to connect with people that just show up. And give them a call. that will work wonders. And I think that everybody in ministry, regardless of what position you occupy, you need the experience of working, of seeing people. You know, sometimes this might be debatable, but I'm just going to throw it out there. Now, sometimes we can be perfectly content, like me, everybody else, as long as we are teaching people and sowing into people's lives and building them up. Okay, but I'm going to tell you about me. That only goes to a certain point. If you're always sowing into people, and many times there's no fruit of righteousness resulting from, you know, that. And sometimes you can just see people hearing the word, and many times they are not what? They are not being fruitful in terms of doing the works of Jesus. And sometimes that can be very discouraging, and sometimes people get to the point where they hear you and they don't what?
Hear you.
Okay. But for me, you know, I don't know about you, I have to kind of leave the saints sometimes, or to not focus on them and focus on somebody in an effort to what? To lead them to Christ or talk with them about their soul, even if they don't receive sometimes. So I think it should be a twofold approach. We need to work in the church, teach in the church, minister to each other in the church, help to build each other up. You know, we can do that in a lot of different ways, but there's nothing that will impact your life like ministering to a lost soul or a person that needs to be saved or filled with the Holy Spirit. So we need to focus. And to me, I don't think that you'll have a shortage in finding these people. Is that right?
Right.
Okay, how far do you have to go to find somebody just to talk to them? You know, well, they accept it or not. You know, sometimes you just want to release yourself, right? So that blood won't be on what?
Your hands.
And this scripture that I'm reading here, it says, the Lord make you to increase and abound in love one toward another and toward all men. In other words, it's for the saints. Amen. We have to minister and love, you know, the saints and do what we need to do. Pray for them, encourage them, admonish them, teach them and all that. That's for the saints. You know, that's good. But the other, it says toward all men. It says what? Toward what? All men. And this is the reason why we want to begin to go out and minister to people outside. Okay, we have the Country Club Pleasure waiting for us to come and do services and minister to the senior citizens. They're waiting for us. All right. We want to do the outreach. The outreach means that in terms of the marriage and relationship. Okay, I think we're going to talk about it a little bit, hopefully, tonight. I thought maybe we could show the marriage DVDs, because I understand it's very, very powerful. Maybe show it to the saints and see when the young couples can all come together, and we try to figure out a time that will be most convenient for those that really, really would need it. Okay, but after, I think that we understand and understand the message that this series of DVDs are going to convey, I think that we need to go out and do what? Let others know that we have something that can what? That can minister to them in this area of their lives. So that means that you have to what? You have to go out and what? And you have to go out and what? Tell people about it. I don't understand what I'm saying.
Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
I thought y'all would be shouting by now. My Pastor Pete? Amen. I can't wait until we can show it so that we can go out and let them know what it's about. Man alive, I can't wait. I mean, you know, I wouldn't be scared at all. Knocking on doors or meeting them down here at Gateway, Reese's, what else do people go? Hey, I just want to... Walmart. All right. That's a good place. Go to the clubs. The club. How many have made a practice and witness at the club?